Good to go.
Good, because we are live right as you said that you're good to go.
All
So
right.
it's pretty good timing.
Well, now I'm on the spot. Am I actually good to go or?
Are you? Yeah, you're just kind of good to
Oh.
go. But yeah, nothing really going on this week.
Yeah, and we are here live at the official E3 bedroom.
Yeah, this is actually just a really elaborate setup for a boring game. It's like Gone Home 2. That's where we're at.
Which I thought we were getting this year, and I was really disappointed
Disappointed,
to
yeah.
see that we weren't.
I've tried to keep up. I've mostly just watched the main conferences. I didn't see anything live this year.
I have to say, like, I mean, we talked about it last week, but I was pretty sure I wasn't going to watch any of the press conferences because we
You're
don't get
never really
really.
excited for him. Like, I mean,
They feel more like work than they
yeah.
feel because. And this year was no exception. I thought every press conference I watched was pretty terrible.
It's
Except, like, the only one I kind of liked was Sony. And not because Sony had, like, a great lineup. I thought they had a pretty poor lineup overall. But they just focused on showing games.
Yeah,
Like,
it
they
was
didn't
one of
do any
those
weird
things.
dance numbers.
The what was it, Monday night that Sony, it was either Monday or yeah, it had to be. It wasn't yesterday. I guess it could have been Sunday. I can't keep track
Oh, it
anymore
was Monday.
because nothing. It's like, hey, the show starts on Thursday, but all the shows are conferences are starting on Saturday. You're like, what? Well, then the
Right.
show starts on
Yeah.
Saturday. What? But anyway, I was my phone battery was too like low to because I was sitting on the couch watching the stuff on the f my phone while I watched TV. And I made the mistake of draining my battery finishing up Microsoft's conference, which I had missed from earlier.
Right.
And so I couldn't watch Sony's live, but I was watching Twitter and everybody was like losing their shit over it. And it's like, oh,
Yeah,
good.
Bill, a lot of people thought Sony did pretty well, but like we'll get into specifics, but like for me, if Giant Bomb wasn't doing their thing of like they were talking over all the press conferences, like that made it a lot more bearable
I don't know.
to
That
like.
just I saw that and I'm like, that sounds obnoxious. I don't want people talking over like I'm already doing my own dialogue in my head when I'm watching this stuff. I don't want somebody else's.
I can understand that, but Jeff Gerstmann's one of the funniest people on the
Yeah.
internet, so.
Well, the funny thing is like I said, well, I saw that they were doing that and like I get that they're doing it and I get that some people would like it, but I'm like, that sounds terrible. At the same time, I'd be like the first person if I had the means to like live stream the show and talk on it, I would do it. Like that sounds obnoxious, but I'm gonna do it.
I totally do it, but. Like that's kind of the mystery science theater thing of
Right.
like I can talk over bad movies and make it fun for me, but it's also fun to watch other people do it.
See, that's what and my maybe 'cause I didn't watch it, so I don't know, but all I was picturing was like the Because it's so easy to be cynical and snarky because there is a lot of bad parts, there's a lot of down stuff, and I just didn't really want to hear that. Like, I don't
Well,
know if they get
there was some
ex.
of that, but they're also, they're like us. They see things like, all right, that looks cool. And they don't talk like they want to hear the shit too. So there's only a few spots where I was like, man, these guys need to shut up because they're explaining the thing that they're confused about. Like there was a moment, we're jumping ahead a little bit, but when they showed God of War off. Where Brad Shoemaker was like, that's not Kratos, is it? And it's like, it's totally fucking Kratos.
Yeah, like
Like,
it was pretty obvious from the second.
bald guy with the fucking, weird skin paint and shit, and the same scar that Zeus stabbed him. Like, of course that's Kratos. Like, are you kidding me? No, it's just some guy who really looks like Kratos.
It's Kratos's twin brother that
Yeah.
has never been mentioned in the series before.
They do mention his brother. Like, I
Oh,
think that's one of the
okay.
portable games.
I lied. So they have mentioned Kratos's brother, and that's exactly who that was.
Yeah.
It was interesting because I've played Chains of Olympus, maybe one of the PSP ones.
I think that's the one I played.
And it was fine. I didn't dislike it. I didn't love it. I mean, it is what it is. It's basically a mindless action game.
And that's kind of God of War for me,
Yeah.
is like I don't think it's I don't think it's the best action game, but I don't think it's like anything. It's almost like, for me, the Uncharted of action games, where you kind of just watch more shit happen than like cool shit happen than you feel like you've actually pulled off.
Right. Well, and like I said, I'm not criticizing it for that. I enjoyed it. I talk about from time to time how much I loved Azura's Wrath, and it's the same. Almost, it's more so that, where all the cool parts are you just watching, and
right.
The gameplay stuff's just thrown in so you can call it a game. There's nothing wrong with that if you do it good and it's entertaining. So I get why people like the series.
But. Yeah, but I also, yeah, well, we'll get to it. I do want to get into currently playing before we, like, I have a whole goddamn list here of E3 things to talk about. But I do want to mention I did pick up Overwatch after last week's show.
That's right. And you streamed it last night, and if I could have stayed up any later, I would have watched, but.
Well, I that was kind of a test stream to see. Like, I haven't tried streaming since I got this new processor, so I wasn't sure what it could handle, but it looked okay. I checked the stream after I was done, played about an hour and a half, and it looked like it ran all right and it looked good. So hopefully there'll be a few more Overwatch streams. I'm definitely gonna play it more. I've been playing it nightly, and it's one of those games that, not since when I first got into Counter-Strike, has there been so many instances of like, okay, I actually have to like drag myself to bed.
See, because I'm surprised, because when you first started playing it, my impression was that you weren't really that enamored with it.
No, I was pretty impressed right away. It's a game that you kind of have to learn each, like, the character's abilities, like how to use them effectively, and I still don't have all that down, but I think I came in at the right time, because the game has this mode called like the weekly brawl mode, and it's like a random setting type matchup. So when I came in, the weekly brawl was every time you died, you became a random hero. And that's a really good way to like understand, like to learn what characters can do and not do,
not
and
only
what
that,
situations.
But it prevents that. Does the game let you have more than one of the same hero on a team? See, that's what I thought. I got the impression of, and it sounded like there's just like a handful of heroes that, not everybody, like literally, but there's like Reaper, isn't that one of them, or whatever the guy is? And it seems like there's always two or three or four of them on a team.
Well, it's kind of the way. Something I kind of like about the game is that after playing it for about a week, a little less than a week, I have a preferred character in like each section of your team. And the game, and when you're putting your team together before the match, the game shows you like, okay, you need you don't have a support character. Somebody needs to be a support character. And it's not like you can play however you want, but it's like if you want a well-rounded team, you're going to want a healer. And the healers are like, some of them are really effective. Like, it's all based off of like what you prefer. So my ideal healer is this character Lucio, who's pretty popular, because his healing's just this passive ability that he can kind of like, he has an ability that makes it go like you heal quicker, but it's this passive thing of just being next to guys. They sort of gradually get their HP back, but he has a little bit of offensive capability and he's really fast. So I probably put the most time into him initially, because that was the problem I had at the beginning, was nobody wanted to be a support character for some reason. And I'm like, it confuses me, because like I said, like this character I'm playing as is, he's fucking the best. I just don't want to play as him every time.
Yeah, games like that, I think people are drawn to like the big flashy damage like characters, but support is probably the most important, and I think it's fun to play when you're the one keeping like your important characters alive. And so I always liked playing healer in Heroes of the Storm.
Sure, and I think that's what really impressed me out the gate with Overwatch, is how all the abilities are. Well, there's a few ultimates I'm having trouble pulling off, but for the most part, all the abilities are really simple to use and self-explanatory. So you always feel like, even though you're just starting out, you always feel like you're being productive on some level. Unless you just have a match where you get fucking wasted because the game matched you up with like three level 30s. But the one thing I was kind of down on, and that why you might think I was kind of annoyed with it, was like there was like a 2-day stretch where it just felt like I was playing with the biggest pricks. And that was something I was nervous about. I got it on PC because you can get it on PC for $40.
I just think a game like that with keyboard and mouse is still my...
Yeah, you know, I have coworkers who wanted to play with me on PS4, and it was kind of tempting because it does seem like a game that would benefit from having like a regular round of friends to play with. But like for me, it was mostly a money thing. But also playing Doom on PC kind of reaffirmed that like mouse and keyboard is kind of the way to go. Even though this game, like, there's so many weapons that like you don't always have to be so precise, but because I'm playing on PC, people are talking more. And
yeah, is it easy to mute them? Because that's important.
Well, for the most part, I haven't had too many people on mic talk. When I say talk, I mean like in the chat. The people who have gotten on mic have actually been helpful because they're awkward people like me, and they just they're just
trying to coordinate. Yeah,
they just say there's a junk rat up on the jet. You know, go up on the jet, kill the junk rat, and it's like, well, if I get to it, I'll get to it. But thank you. But like people in the in-game chat have been just assholes about like stuff to me that doesn't make sense. And it's not that I'm saying that what they're suggesting is wrong, but they act like assholes because I don't know.
Yeah. Any competitive game like that, you get a segment of people that think every single person should be like, know every nook and cranny of the game, like all the like frame data and, yeah. I don't know, just like, yeah, it, not all of us have no jobs and no lives, and we spend all day on the forums reading about the absolute, like, ideal combination of whatever.
Right.
And you know what's funny, too, is those are the people that usually, I can't speak for Overwatch, I haven't played Overwatch, but it's Heroes of the Storm, I used to play it a ton, I know you loved hearing about that, but same type of ideal, it's a highly competitive team-based game. And the more successful teams, at least unless you know, if you're on like the pro circuit and you're playing for $1 million pot, that's different. But the more successful teams weren't necessarily the ones that knew every single mechanic about the game the best. They were the ones that could just work well together and adapt. And those ones that sit and bitch, like you're talking about in chat, usually were the ones that would cost you the game, because instead of adapting and just rolling with things,
they just wanted to play their way. And that's what happened with this guy. In fact, I think we won the match, but he was just bitching because it was the match where it was randomizing my hero every time I died. So I got one of the tanks who I'm not really like, I don't really like playing as him. He's got a big hammer and he has a giant shield, but he's just not my speed of tank. My speed of tank is the girl with a giant robot. And like when the robot dies, she pops out of it. Yeah. Well, her name's Diva, just letter D and V. So she's the best.
Creative.
Yeah. Very creative. And so I was using his shield and I'm in the middle of this giant firefight and I can't pay attention to I'm just trying to defend and like find an opening to do this character's charge. And the guy, this guy was the healer, and he was like pissed at me for keeping my shield up when he was healing me. And I was like, well, why are you healing me when I'm at full health? Right. Like, go heal one of our teammates. I have a shield. That's what it's for. Like I said, I'm new to the game. I'm not saying there isn't wisdom to his strategy. Maybe he can heal me faster than my shield can degrade. I don't know. But he acted like it was the most obvious thing ever. And luckily, you can easily go onto his profile and be like, I don't want to play with that prick anymore.
See, that's awesome. Heroes had a where you could block somebody so that they don't show up in your chat. But I was never 100% sure that meant you couldn't get matched up with them again. I think it did.
Well, but, I mean, I think I could still get matched up with that guy, because they say, like, they phrase it as, like, avoid this player, which still leaves kind of room. But there are 10 million people playing Overwatch. Right. So,
and it probably takes it into account then, so it probably does its best to not.
Yeah, I mean, like, if you can't find me a matchup with 10 million other people, I probably wouldn't have gotten another game with him anyway.
It would get super abused, but, man, if you could put, like, Nemesis this player so it intentionally tries to match you up against them, like...
Yeah, I think that would have to be, like, two people who agree to it.
Well, that's the problem, is it's too easy to troll people with that, but that would be great.
Yeah, you'd get so many, like, level 40s, like, going after level 8s.
Right. But you're liking the game. That's kind of good and distressing, because...
I really like it. It's so much fun. Like, I haven't been addicted to a shooter like this since Counter-Strike.
Well, if I get some kind of windfall and I can get it, maybe we can have Overwatch streams.
We should.
Yeah.
Because, like I said, I intend to keep streaming it.
Call it Broverwatch. Ha ha ha. Because, you know,
all right, the show's over. Yeah. Fuck E3. Fuck the website. Fucking Njoystic. That was a terrible pun.
Watching. Anyway, go ahead. Yeah. So the balance seems really well.
They just did a nerf and a buff thing on a couple of the characters. One of them is kind of my offensive go-to. The cowboy, McCree.
Yeah, and he just looks awesome, by the way. That's...
Well, his right-click shot is to fan the hammer, so he just sprays, like, 6 shots rapid-fire. And they nerfed that because it was killing tanks really quickly. Like, all 6 shots would hit them. And so, people were happy about that. Like, they think it's just the cheapest thing ever. Doesn't really affect me, though, because I don't use that ability very often with him. Like, I just like his normal shot because it's a revolver, so it's really powerful. Like, you do a huge chunk of health per shot. Yeah. So, like, most enemies go down in, like, 3 hits. He's pretty cool.
And that's the thing. The balance things will keep happening up and down, and, you know, one character will might get buffed and then nerfed, or nerfed and then buffed later on, but that's not a big... A lot of people get caught up on that stuff, too. Like, oh, you just ruined my favorite character. It's like, you'll learn to adapt. I mean,
I was kind of talking about that in the stream last night. Like, I have ideas of, like, what I think they should do with certain characters, because... one of the characters, May, is like, she can encase herself in ice and heal. Yeah. And I think you should be able to shoot that ice barrier. And if you do enough damage, it breaks before she can fully heal again.
I got the impression that that's how it worked, just because I was watching. So, but it must break maybe once you're fully healed.
Yeah, it breaks once she's fully healed. And I think it should be that way. But I'm not, like, that upset about it. And the big character is Bastion. Everybody fucking hates Bastion. I kind of... Like, it's like when you had that random match and you got Bastion after a death, it was fucking great because it felt like luck of the draw. But when people pick Bastion in the normal matches, like, I understand that frustration, and I do feel like he's a little overpowered, like, because he can turn himself into this rapid fire turret and it just mows through you. But rather than kind of, like, I don't see the point of just sitting there and bitching. Like, there are ways to beat him. Say, like, I've done it before. So it's more of a case of, like, yeah, he might be overpowered, but really I just want to learn how to deal with him.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Players get a play style, and then they bitch when they have to, like, learn a different style. It's like, well,
And that's what I, like, that's what I like about where I'm at with the game now. Is because I have a character in every section who I like. And Hanzo, he's the bow and arrow sniper character. I've been having, like, last night I had some really good games with him. I actually took a highlight. It's on, like, a 2-minute video that I kept on YouTube from my stream last night where... Like, we had to defend the area, and, like, we were running out of time, but there's an overtime mode, so if they're actively doing their objective, the game won't end until you kill them all from that area. So I went in and I shot, like, two guys in the head with Hanzo. It was just the most ninja shit. And then I fired a dragon that killed like the third person. I cleaned out the area and we won. And I was certain that would be play of the game. And instead, it went to a Bastion who just turned into a turret and killed six people. And I was just like, man, mine looks so much fucking cooler. Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's I know a lot of people were giving the game shit for that. Not like real critical, like, oh, don't buy this game because the player of the games are stupid. But that's been kind of a running joke. And it's you get it because it has to be picked by some like algorithm or, you know, just some set of code that picks the play of the game.
Yeah,
and that's the kind of thing you really need like a human influence, because there's things that might statistically not look that important that were either really cool or really pivotal.
Well, like I got a play of the game in my stream last night with Hanzo, and it looked cool, but it didn't look planned. So, yes, yellow girl, we are live. I'm sure that's a valid account. But, like, I panicked and I shot a dragon at just one character, which you're not supposed to do. You're supposed to save it for a crowd. But I thought he was going to kill me. And then I shot two people in the head. And that was play of the game somehow, even though it only ended with, like, killing three people. So I do think it takes into consideration, like the moment of the match and the appearance.
Right.
But it's hard to compete with, like, a turret that just kills six people. Like, your entire team just gets wiped.
I liked the... And I hope they turned it into a play of the match. There was a... like a Vine, I think it was, or an animated GIF or something I saw. And I think I shared it on Twitter today. And I don't even, like, know anything about the game, but it was just hilarious because the caption was, come on, guys, I know a shortcut. And you see this guy, like, rocket jump out over a ledge. And there must be, like, a double jump you can do or something.
With some characters, they have, like, flying abilities.
Yeah, but the way he did it, in order to get to this ledge, you had to jump and then time it just right to do your second jump or your boost or whatever. Otherwise, you would go too high.
Yeah, it's like a wall jump thing.
Yeah, yeah. And so the caption was, come on, guys, follow me. And you see the first guy run and jump and do it and turn around. And then you see another teammate run around the corner and try it and fall to his death. And then a second one try it and fall to his death. And then a third one try it and fall. And I'm like, play of the game right there. Like,
he was playing as the gorilla, Winston. Mm-hmm. And his ability is this giant leap.
So none of the others could actually make it. They were just trying to follow him.
It looked like some of them could, but it looked like they just both fucked it up.
It was just hilarious because there was literally three suicides right behind. It's like, come on, guys. Oh, no. But I mean,
right now I'm kind of at a point with it where I don't know if I'm going to review it yet. I feel like I should put more time into it. Like, I feel like the mark of a multiplayer game is somewhat longevity.
Well, you've got to be high in the, like, rankings. Low ranks aren't allowed to review stuff.
That's right. You don't get your credentials.
Right.
But I mean, like, Splatoon was such a great shooter, but after, like, a month, like, I still play Splatoon, but it's, like, really sparingly, and I only play, like, a couple of matches here and there when I got a few minutes, and I'm just bored and need something, and Wii U's right by me. But, Overwatch seems like there's a little bit more there to, like, keep me coming back. Like, it's just such a simple system, and all the characters feel really unique. And like I said, all the characters feel like you're contributing something, or you at least have the ability to. And there's nothing, like, there's no huge learning curve with any of them in order to, like, make an impact on your team. So, yeah, it's like between Doom and Overwatch, like, I guess this is the year of the shooter, because, like, those are two of the most impressive games that I've played so far.
Yeah, and it sucks because I keep seeing more Doom stuff. Of course, they talked about it at E3, and it's like, man, I need to play that so bad. Hopefully this paycheck, but...
Yeah, they didn't announce anything I want.
No, I was a little disappointed that they only talked about multiplayer expansion, and I'm sure it'll get some single-player content. You'd think it would have to at some point, but... But I kind of
haven't announced anything.
I kind of get not talking about it. I mean, the game just came out. It's not even a month old.
To be fair, I don't think they expected. I think part of them didn't expect people to like the game so much. Like, probably from, like, where...
I would say I agree, except for they announced that Quake Champions, too. As well, I mean, not too... so it kind of shows, and this was following Wolfenstein, too. I think that they know how much people like these old games being modernized, and they have a lot of confidence in how they're doing it. And they should at this point.
Yeah. But I think with, like, Quake, you know that that's going to be a multiplayer-focused sort of thing. And I think that might have been the mentality is, like, well, we don't know how people will feel about this campaign, so let's just try this weird thing. And it turns out that weird thing is what's, you know, what people really enjoy about Doom. So, yeah, I don't... If my fucking dogs would shut the hell up.
Oh, it doesn't matter. I can't hear them anyway because my headset decided to, like, start shorting out right now. So you keep cutting out. At first, I thought it was the stream. I'm like, uh-oh. And then I'm like, oh, no, my headset. So if you, like, ask a question and I answer, like, oh, banana milkshake, it's because I didn't quite hear you.
Is that your safe word?
Yeah, banana safe word.
Milkshake? Oh, that's a little long.
Yeah.
You gotta...
But it's got double meaning because those are disgusting. So you can tell it's something that I'm not into. Anyway,
so do you have anything you've been playing, or do you want to get into
E3? I haven't touched a video game in like 3 weeks.
That's sad, man.
It really is. Part of it is I still need to. I don't have any money, and I need to replace my controller, and I want to pick up Doom, and everything's just depressing as I look at it as is. But no, I'd still been working on that game in Unity, but that's not really fun to talk about on the stream.
Yeah. So, I guess, like, for me, I just wrote, like, lists of games that stood out to me one way or the other. Like, I didn't really break it down by, like, press conference. The only press conferences I watched were Bethesda's and Sony's, and I saw a little bit of Ubisoft's, and then I decided I didn't need to see any more.
Those are about the one. Let's see, I caught Bethesda's. I watched EA's, which is terrible. It's always terrible. Microsoft, Sony. I haven't got to watch Nintendo's yet. I think I can't remember if I watched Ubisoft. I must have. No, I take that back. I decided not to watch Ubisoft because I looked in all the. I don't even want to use the word cool games because I don't know that they showed any, but all the games that are worth noting were also shown in the other conferences. So, like, I didn't feel any need to specifically watch Ubisoft's.
Yeah. But, well, when it started with a dance number and, like, then they went into, like, serious mode over the Orlando shooting, but Aisha Tyler's standing next to a guy in a giraffe suit. It was just kind of like, all right, well, I'm getting kind of mixed tones here.
Jeffrey the Giraffe says, I don't want to grow up, but I stand with Orlando.
Jeffrey the Giraffe, the spokesman for the LGBT community.
Well, he had to do something after Toys R Us lost all of its, like, relevance.
Giraffes?
Yeah. PETA marched on Toys R Us.
Yeah, like, all giraffes. These people are wearing these weird goddamn costumes and stuff and smiling and, as, like, we're trying to have, like, a somber note for Orlando.
And I kind of blame they're in a tough spot. I mean, a lot of people gave Sony props for the way that they opened it with it. And it's like, and then a lot of people, was it EA, I think, was, like, one of the first ones. And it was, like, right after the shootout. I think I want to say it was on Sunday. Right. And a lot of people gave him a bunch of shit because they're like, oh yeah, you don't even mention it, and then you go on and show a bunch of shooters. It's like, the thing is that when the ones that do mention it, like, does that really help? Because you know that they stand, you know either way, none of them, it's not like EA didn't talk about it, so now I think EA supports mass murder.
Yeah, and it's...
And it gets so awkward. Like, and I'm not saying it was wrong for the people that did address it, but the Sony guy, I mean, it was, you know, somber, and, you know, we stand, you know, we're square with the community, or whatever phrasing he kept giving it. Right. It's like, okay, I get that you're doing it, and I appreciate it, but it also starts to sound like they're using the tragedy as a marketing pitch, and I'm not accusing them of that, but I mean, it's one way or the other, you get a corporation saying,
I
like,
mean, you can't really win.
No.
Like, if you bring it up.
And so my point is, if they don't bring it up, I don't think that that's worth demonizing them for not doing it, but if they do, it's not worth demonizing them for doing it either. I mean, it's just a shitty situation, and there's no good way to address it.
Yeah, I think, you know, it was, I think it was pretty obvious that everybody, you know, feels and stands for the people of Orlando. And I don't even look down on Ubisoft for bringing it up. I just think it was presentation was really, it was poorly chosen. Like, timing.
Well, at least they didn't, like, say, oh, we stand with Orlando. Now, here's this new game called Party Hard, or whatever that one is, that's like Hotline Miami, but it's set in, like, clubs and stuff. It's like, yeah. And this has to be a rumor, because we would have heard something by now, but somebody's like, oh, Microsoft was going to show Red Dead 2, but there was a scene too close to the... shooting, so they pulled it. It's like, well,
the fuck happens in Red Dead 2?
They go into a gay club that's playing techno, and you're like, this ain't cowboy, and start shooting it up. No,
this
is
not my idea of an Old West story.
But so that was one of my favorite rumors going around the other, like, yesterday. It's like, well, I don't know how true that is, because even if I could see them pulling it, saying this timing's too bad, but then Rockstar would have still had to, like, announce it at some point. You don't just say, like, oh, crap, well...
Yeah,
we won't talk about our game now.
There was I think my highlight, like, I'm pissed moment that quickly turned into, like, oh, good moment was, there were rumors that Capcom might announce a new Devil May Cry, and I'm obsessed with that series, so I totally wanted that to be true. And what came out appeared to be a trailer with, Dante's brother Virgil seeming to be the main character, and he cut through, like, a bunch of demons and then stabbed another demon, and it all looked really cheap and weird, and then it, like, was revealed it was a mobile game.
And you're like, sweet, I can ignore that.
It kind of, but I was also like, god damn it, you're really doing a fucking mobile game with Devil May Cry? It's an action game, come on. And then it came out that it wasn't even a Devil May Cry game. It was somebody just ripped the fuck off of the series and released their own thing for E3. So that was the scare of the century. And you're having, like, a fucking conspiracy theory chat about Alan.
Yeah, it worked well, but there. There were a few of those things that they would show, and you'd be like, huh. And then it would turn out to either be something really cool, or it would start out kind of cool, and then you'd be like, oh, yeah, never mind. There was a few, before we get into the specific games, there was two themes that I noticed very, very strongly this year. They're not new, but they were, like, slapping me in the face with their obnoxiousness. The biggest one, I had said something on Twitter, and I know you saw it because you responded, but... There's a lot of games being shown that have co-op in them. Mm-hmm. And these companies have not figured out that scripted, like, crappy
scripted
trying
banner.
To, yeah, trying to, like, because they all try to do the bro talk. And guys, most of us don't actually talk like that. And the ones that do don't have friends.
Yeah, those aren't real friends.
Right. And it's just so jarringly bad. It's worse when they try to do it on stage. And I don't think I saw any this year. Last year they had a few where they would have, like, four people on stage mic'd up, and they'd all be trying to talk to each other, like, yo, dude, check out the helicopter over there on your six. And, like, it's just none of it sounds natural. But there was a lot of it that was pre-recorded, and it still had that.
We can... This is in my list of Sea of Thieves. Everything yeah. Everything about that game sounds perfect for me.
And it, I did appreciate that it shows that you have to work together. Like, you have to literally talk to your team to accomplish stuff. But
I like pirates. I don't like socializing. So,
and a game like that,
that I have to actually have a crew to sail my ship, kind of, it bugs me.
See, I kind of like it because I think, but it depends on. The problem there is then the game 100% relies on its community. And we've talked about it before. I won't get into it because we want to talk about current stuff. But there's been a few games, notably MMOs. Conan, what was it? Not Unchained. That was a remake. But Age of Conan Online or whatever the hell it was now. It's been too long. That game was actually pretty good, but the community was toxic and shitty, and it made it no fun to play the game. Mm-hmm. Warhammer Online was really good. World of Warcraft, but its community wasn't a bad, it wasn't a toxic community, it just never built up enough community to
and if Sea of Thieves is like, if I was actually playing with those assholes who were playing the game for E3, there won't be a fucking community either. It'll just be those dicks and they're the only ones playing the game. Like, the stuff you're doing in that game looks cool, it's just I couldn't finish what they showed. I couldn't finish watching it because I was just like, all right, this is so fucking obnoxious that, like, it totally turned me off to it. So, like, I should have come away like feeling like, yeah, Sea of Thieves, I have my eye on it. And instead I'm just sort of like, the game itself looks good, I just really wish they presented it better.
Yeah, the one that was the worst to me was the Ghost Recon the Wildlands or whatever that one's called.
That was pretty bad, yeah.
Yeah.
And that was another one that looked all right. The combat looked kind of boring, honestly. Like, how many times do you just go after the objective arrow on an open world game? Like, I'm just sort of, I'm done with that mechanic.
Right.
But, you know, like, the banter made it seem that much more dull, boring.
Especially since they did that overly, like, trying to be like Tango Down, and
yeah, what the fuck? You don't know what Tango is. Right. Shut up.
I don't think they ever actually said that specific phrase, but it was just too corny. Like, nobody would ever actually talk like that, and I don't get why they don't just get like four people and have them play a game and record how they're like actually communicating and say, here you go. I get why they don't do it live. Somebody had a really good point. When you try it live, like they did with Soul Calibur, I think it was, or Killer Instinct maybe, and I think it was last year, and one of the guys like, oh, I'm going to rape you. It's like, ooh, yeah, don't ever say that live on an E3 presentation. But
don't say that.
Right.
You'll get in fucking big trouble. Don't say it.
Especially since I think it was a female character that he was up against. It's like, And that did not go over well. So I get that they're trying to avoid things like that, but these were all pre-recorded things. So it's not like you can have a slip up and be like, oh crap. Because it's like, okay, take two or bleep it out or edit it, whatever. But just the scripted lines were terrible. So that was grating on me. And then this has just been getting worse and worse, in my opinion, since we started really paying attention to E3 in 2010, when it started the site. But the they'll come out and they're like, oh, we're here's our game, and we're really excited to tell you something about it in a few months or next year. It's like, oh, well, that was exciting.
Yeah. That seemed like the big case this year was just so many, like, we're making this thing, but it's going to be a while. And it's like, okay, well, what do you have? How's 2016 looking? Well, we got a couple things. Then like something will be out early 2017, and then we have no idea.
But the problem is we're smart enough to know anything that they're like, well, yeah, it's early 2017. Well, that doesn't mean crap. By the time early 2017 comes around, it might be.
Well, that's when they'll release their new consoles, and then hopefully everybody will buy those, and that way they don't have to worry about making God of War work on an old PS4 or some shit.
That was weird to me. It was nice that, and it was one thing we said last year, that was refreshing, because we had just come out of the whole like 2 years of lead up to new hardware. Like the first year was like all speculation, and the year before was, we know something's coming, and we're finally going to talk about it. And so it was like 90% focus on hardware. So last year was nice having it like all focus on software, and this year so far has been mostly software. I'm surprised there hasn't been more VR talk, but it seems like these companies are smart enough to know how hard it is to show VR on a big stage. Like, from what I understand, there's a ton of it going on, like demoing and hands-on and stuff, but they were smart enough to mostly leave it out of their main presentations, because it, a VR game being shown as a regular game on a screen doesn't look very impressive, and it gives a bad impression. So there wasn't a lot of that, but there was the Scorpio, and I missed somehow, even though I went back and rewatched the Microsoft stuff, I didn't really catch them talking about Scorpio, which I assume is the code name for their next system.
Well, yeah, I'm not too sure what that is, because they also announced the Xbox One remodel, which is coming in August.
One S or something.
Yeah.
And that's what was confusing. They're like, well, we're going to admit Scorpio's being worked on, but not tell you what it is, but you can spend more money and buy this other upgraded Xbox. Yeah. It's like, well, but if you already in same breath said you're working on something else, like, that's a weird sales pitch. Be like, hey, that box that you bought last year is already obsolete. You can buy a new one, and we're working on something else that you can buy. It's like, well, I'm a little hesitant now.
I'm just not, especially now that I'm still trying to be wooed by VR. And I'm just like, I don't have the energy to like wrap my head around these like hardware iterations, like how they're trying to change how hardware is upgrade and stuff. But, and I thought they were going to do more to like sell us on VR, especially Sony, who just like came out and like, hey, there's a Batman VR thing. And it's like, what is it? Well, you wear the cowl.
Yeah.
Well, what? Okay. But what the fuck do you do? Like that? Like Batman's the weirdest thing to do VR for.
Well, it could be really cool, but it's
hard. It could be, but I don't know what it is, because they just showed Batman's big head.
I know, and it's those are going to be the experiences that we're really going to have to rely on the actual journalists that are actually there
actually playing them,
right? And then we'll turn around and regurgitate whatever they say with our own opinions. But
well, the problem there is like, it's like everything else with VR is like, how much of it is like, you know, this is actually a good game and you should play it, versus like, hey, I played this weird thing at an event, you know, but it's not a game, but it's an experience. And hopefully they do something with that idea. I still don't see the end game. Like, I like with VR, I don't see, like, I would like it to work out, but I don't see like what the games are that are going to be selling you on these expensive headsets and shit.
Yeah, and there was a couple. I think the one that I saw that I'd be the most interested in is for completely like nostalgic reasons was, and I wish it was a standalone game, although I imagine we'll get one, was the X-Wing VR mission for Battlefront. Because I played X-Wing and TIE Fighter and X-Wing versus TIE Fighter. I played the shit out of that as a kid. And to be able to actually like play a game like that where you're flying an X-Wing or an A-Wing or a TIE Fighter, whatever, through space, and be able to actually like look around the cockpit and stuff while you're doing it, that would be amazing. I think from the first person standpoint, those are the type of games, the Elite Dangerous or Star Citizen, although that one I would there's red flags all over the damn place with Star Citizen. I'd stay away from it. But like the whole space, or even like a regular flight sim with VR from first person, is one of the cooler applications there. Maybe a racing game. And then there's a lot of other really cool applications outside of the stereotypical first person shooter. I forget the one. There's something about werewolves, like it's a weird name, and the game is literally, it's a multiplayer VR game where you're literally just sitting around a campfire talking to each other, and the premise is one of you is a werewolf and you have to figure out who. And it's almost more of like a board game type experience. Like that's the kind
that
of thing.
That sounds like a board game I know about.
Yeah, so and it might
maybe
be based
they, maybe
on
they
that.
Made a VR thing. Yeah.
Right. And something like that would be really, really cool. And I can't wait to see those interesting applications. The reality of it is, though, those kind of games don't sell hardware. They're a nice bonus once you have the hardware, but it's going to take something much grander to actually get
people. Like, the closest thing I've seen to, like, a hard sell was Resident Evil 7, when they said you can play through the entire game in VR. Of course, now I've played the demo, you kind of get an idea why you could do that. But that's probably the one title I've seen that, like, made any sort of push to, like, be like, yeah, VR, you're gonna like, this game will be good on its own, but you're gonna love it in VR. Like, that's how it seemed like they were selling it. But yeah, we'll get to that. The other theme I noticed was people playing the games live who are really fucking bad at playing video games.
Well, that gives someone like me hope, though. That means one day I may be able to stand on stage and play.
Yeah, maybe one day they'll give you a job. But, like, I would rather watch pre-recorded shit than watch somebody bumble around. Like watching the gameplay of Zelda, probably the most interesting game of E3, as far as, like, people, like, what's this going to be? What are they going to do different? Oh, my God, it looks gorgeous. Like, what's in the world to do? And instead, like, every gameplay thing was just this guy kind of bumbling around killing moblins. And it's like, there's got to be more interesting things to fucking do. Like, don't waste your goddamn time just throwing barrels around to show that you can throw barrels.
Yeah,
you could always throw barrels. It's fucking Zelda.
Well, and see, the thing with Zelda is, though, they had the main presentation, which I still haven't seen, but then, like, pretty much every major publication there got hands-on gameplay time with it as well. I did watch somebody from IGN play it, and it was interesting enough just because they were with somebody, so that actually, and I take that back, the guy from IGN was just talking to one of the developers, and there was somebody else playing it in the background, like one of the Nintendo staff. Like, I guess it wasn't hands on, it was like a guided demo. But yeah, I mean, it like you say, that part was kind of boring because it was just like, oh, walk around. From what I understand, they cut out, they literally, like, went in and deleted out a lot of, like, content. Like, yeah. Whole towns they took out just because they don't want to give spoilers away, and I appreciate that. But that left it, like you said, it's just like, oh, look, you can walk over here and shoot an arrow at this goblin and then fight them. It's like, yeah. Cool.
Well, there's just one point where, like, the guy got to a moblin campsite and there was a boulder above them clearly meant to push onto them, and instead he walked around the boulder and just fought him straight. And it's like, if you're not gonna, like, try shit and show the game off, what are you here for?
Right.
And Final Fantasy 15, I think, took a bigger hit than anything for that.
Oh yeah,
it looked awful. I can't believe they showed that.
The thing is, I still kind of want to play it.
I do too. Because the stuff they showed before, I thought looked pretty good.
Well, and the thing is, it kind of showed that it's got almost that MMO style RPG action combat, but that doesn't demo particularly well.
That's not what I went to when I saw, like, I saw the Titan fight.
It ran.
And that looked, like, that guy either fucking sucked at their game, or that is a horrible fight.
I was kind of watching it, but I was watching it, like I said, on my cell phone. I had headphones in, but I was watching soccer, so I know how much you care about that. Did he die halfway through that fight and have to restart it?
I don't remember, because I just remember, like, him getting knocked down over and over again by the Titan's giant arm and getting, like, as if I was playing the game, like, getting pissed at the game, because I'm just like, are you kidding me? This is the whole fight? You just attack his hand? Like,
Well, the thing that got me about it was that he seemed to have an unavoidable swipe attack. I was like,
yeah, like it didn't seem like there was like a real way to avoid that. And that's, you know, coming from something like Dark Souls, I'm like, all right, in Dark Souls, yeah, you do attack hands and ankles and shit, but you can get out of the way of pretty much anything. Like, how the fuck are you so limited in this? Like, right. You have magical dashes.
Well, that's what it looked like. He was trying to, like, magical dash through the arm, but it looked like he never once pulled it off.
Yeah, and that's what I'm wondering is, like, is that... And it's what I'm nervous about now, because in the trailer, they showed, like, three different titans. And if you have to do that fight over and over again, fuck that.
Here's his swipey arm. Yeah. The only thing that I was disappointed, and we might still get it, they announced it for Xbox One as well. That was, like, the big announce there, because up until, like, 2 days ago, it was a PlayStation exclusive. Although, I don't think they ever said it, but it had only been talked about or shown for PlayStation.
I don't know if that's true. I think they just kept it like a vague, will be out for platforms.
But they still haven't announced PC, and if they don't announce PC, I won't be playing it more than likely because I don't have a.
It might not come out at the same time, but I'm sure it'll get a PC release if it's going on the Xbox.
I was hopeful because that was one of the big things. Everybody hated it, Microsoft's presser, and loved Sony's, and. To be honest, to me, they were much closer in my book because they were both rather boring but had some cool games. But I was most excited about Microsoft's push towards this one play or whatever they're calling it, where a lot of their games, especially their exclusives, are going to be cross-platform play between Xbox One and PC. And if you buy it digitally, you get it for both platforms and your saves all transfer and you can play against each other. And that's really fucking great news for me because that means I don't have to buy an Xbox, which I don't want to do.
Which is a weird sales strategy.
Right. Well, it's basically them admitting they lost the console race there.
And I think, like, you know, I think it's good for consumers, but I wonder what it says about the future of the Xbox where they're just like... Because at this point, if I was interested, like... I think the 500 gigabyte Xbox One S will be like $300.
But from what I understand, it doesn't come with a controller.
Yeah, it doesn't come with a controller. But like, even that would kind of interest me. But I have a PC, so now it's like, well, anything you release, I'm probably going to be able to play.
Now I had to admit that they probably did finally like get me in that like say uncle where I'll have to upgrade to Windows 10 because I've been putting that off. And I'm not going to do it yet. I'll hold off. I'll still hold off until there's a game out that I absolutely have to play.
I did it, and I haven't had any problems with Windows 10. Hey, it's probably ran better for me than Windows 8 did, honestly. But
see, well, there's a couple fears I have with it, but the biggest one is that it'll use more RAM, meaning games will run less well. I know English.
Upgrade your RAM. It's not expensive.
I don't have money for a controller. I don't.
RAM is not as expensive as a controller. It can be. There's no way. I mean, I don't know, but to me that seems impossible.
Yeah, well, it's not just RAM. It's then processor and whatever and video card. Like I just worry performance overall for games will be slower.
Maybe. I mean, I think it's probably pretty negligible, honestly. You've played games on your PC. Like, you played The Witcher, so I think you'll be fine.
But The Witcher I did have to play on relatively low setting, which was amazing because it still looked better than any other fucking game I'd ever played.
Right. But, that's just The Witcher being a really demanding game, honestly. Right. I don't think it had anything to do with, like,
yeah, because then you could talk about Metal Gear Solid 5. I played that on PC, and I played that on its highest settings, and it ran fine. So it's kind of I don't have a power computer. It was a pre-built something I bought from Amazon, and it is 2 years old. But it's run everything pretty well so far. Yeah. But that's why I worry, because I feel like I'm shortening its shelf life if I go to 10. But I'm going to have to do it.
That's one point. Yeah. I mean,
especially with this new thing. I mean, with this one play, that's awesome for PC owners.
Well, aren't they stopping the free upgrade to 10? Like, isn't that on a time limit?
They say it is, but I don't know that they'll ever actually enforce it because they want you to upgrade.
Yeah. Well, with that little deviation into
stuff,
computer problems.
But that's so that was Microsoft. That was the thing I liked best about their conference was the one play. Forza looked amazing too, though. I'd be more excited for it if I actually liked racing games. But out of racing games, Forza is the one I like the best, and the new one looks pretty cool.
Yeah, I didn't. I'm not really a racing game guy, so I didn't really pay attention to that. But I heard everybody say it looked great. Horizon Zero Dawn. Like, I know you knew about this game. I haven't really paid attention to it.
They announced it last year's E3, I think. Yeah, right. It might have been PAX Prime, but I thought it was E3 last year.
Like, I knew the title, but I never really followed it, and I knew there were, like, animal robots.
Yeah.
But what they showed at the Sony conference looked really good.
Yeah, I worry, though, that it's going to be turn into that repetitive, like, oh, this is really cool for 10 minutes, and now it's just...
Yeah, I agree with that. There was concern from a gameplay standpoint of, like, if this is all there is to it, then, you know, will this hold for an entire game? But from a visual standpoint, like, the designs of those animal robots and stuff, like, then, like, that game has a lot of potential, yeah. I think.
But that was another one. This goes into when they didn't have co-op douchebags talking to each other, they had protagonists talking way too fucking much.
Yeah.
And that was one of the games that was guilty of that. Well, maybe if I scan this. Oh, now there's a weak spot. Well, I should hit it. Oh, it's weak to fire. It's like, shut up.
Yeah, why am I controlling you if you already know everything? Like, you know how to beat the game.
What normal person would be saying these things out loud, like, while they're doing them?
Yeah, do you need me here? Do you want to just shoot this thing yourself?
And I meant to write that one down as, like, a separate one. But and that it was far from the only game. I think Watch Dogs 2 did it, but there's enough negative things that I could say about that game. But a lot of games had the protagonist that wouldn't shut up.
That's like theme number 4 is, like, characters just need to shut the fuck up.
Yeah, like Cabbage is saying in our chat, do a barrel roll. That's a classic example.
Yeah. Well, Peppy Hare, you know, that was constructive advice. Do a barrel roll because it will save your life. These people are just like, hey, you want to do this so we don't take 5 minutes to learn how to play the game?
As you're, like, walking through the jungle, maybe I should press select to open my map. You're like, what? What?
Yeah, it's, fuck you. Let me learn. I'll do it. I don't need a goddamn... Like, they cut out the tutorial. Now it's just instructions from the main character. Like, hey, idiot. Fucking use your item that will tie the robot down. God of War was really interesting to me because and I think everybody, and I, like, I'm not a huge fan of the series, like, I think it's all right, but the fact that they're changing it up so much, like, I you kind of have to give them props, like, because it's such an established, it would have been so easy to just make another God of War that's on PS4 and, like, hey, look how good it looks, but it's the same shit. And for them to, like, change your perspective and kind of change how the combat works, like, making it a little more personal like that, like, I think that's pretty bold. And
but, like, they're going to have to, like, change the title to, like, Abusive Dad of War.
Like, he was an abusive dad. He was a piece of shit. Like, that's the one thing about it is, like, Kratos is a fucking douchebag. Yeah.
Well, it was funny because at first it's like I got the impression that that wasn't his son because he's obviously had no, like, interaction with him because
he's
like,
a loveless man.
What has your mom taught you? Because I have not been around until she's apparently dead. Right. Like, I didn't want anything to do with your life. So what's been going on?
Like, I've been busy ripping off heads. Yeah, I mean, he's always been a bastard, and it always confuses me that he's, like, this beloved icon of, like, Sony. Like, he was in All-Stars, and, like, he shows up in
Mortal Kombat. Well, I mean, he's one of, like, the few exclusive, like, mascots that they have, but, Yeah, he's not.
I've had a lot of mascots over the years, but few with the longevity that he's had. It's like him and Nathan Drake are like these mascots for PlayStation. And it's like he's such a fucking, he's such garbage. He's so horrible. And he deserves everything bad that's ever happened to him.
Right. But no, it looked interesting, and they did a really good job. It'll be shallow, I think, like any video game is that's based on killing the countless things. Right. But the way that the kid froze, like on the troll, killing the troll, and then the scene where he shot the deer and then had to like finish it off, that was really powerful to me. And a part of it was just the way
it was very The Last of War.
They managed to capture how shitty it is. I know you've had a couple animals that you've had to put down. I had to put down my dog a year ago, and you know you were there with it when it died, and they captured that so well with that animal. The difference there was that it was being hunted, but they still like had some actual like weight to this is a life that you're taking. And it's like, I thought that was amazing, but you know that'll go on and like 5 seconds later, it's a video game and it.
And then Kratos will rip the head off and be like, we're taking this for the dinner.
We're going to go find its wife and babies and we're going to rub this head in their faces while we eat
and
it.
And I will kill it because of my rage.
But that was a really cool presentation. And the music, if nothing else, it's like, well, you've sold me on the soundtrack. Because
everyone knew God of War was coming when they brought in that orchestra. But like I said, you know, they did kind of the impossible, and that was make me care about a God of War game at E3, which like I for every time they've shown a God of War game at E3, I've completely ignored it because I know it's not really my type of action game. I think there are a lot better ones out there. But I like that they're taking a chance on that. We didn't see much of this, but Insomniac's doing a Spider-Man game. I think that's, you know, that's probably Spider-Man's best shot at having a good game now.
Yeah, I mean, that's another one, though, that I thought, like, this looks really cool, but it also looks like 5 seconds in, I'm going to get tired of just, like, jumping on dudes' heads from...
Yeah, and that's something I was thinking about with Zelda is, like, you know, it's kind of the same thing with God of War, where I think everybody's really impressed with how ambitious Nintendo is in trying to change up the formula. But is it going to be a situation where you just do another open world game? Like, what? Like, and Nintendo seems like a company that would believe they were innovating just because they did something that they haven't done before without realizing that every other game on the planet has been doing open world stuff. You know, I'm optimistic. I think they will put their own spin on that type of game. But Spider-Man could very easily just turn into another, like, hey, go to the objective and beat up people. And it's like, kind of need more to do than that. But Insomniac is a pretty good team of developers, so
yeah.
Hopefully, I like the look they gave Spider-Man, like with the white logo and stuff. It's different. Resident Evil 7. So I actually played the demo they released of that.
You mean PT? Or they should have just literally called it not PT RE. With like fingers, like.
But yeah, you could easily do that, like, you like have the PT logo and then just like add the line to make it an R and then like move some shit, add two more lines, and you got RE.
But that's not you were talking about it, it's like, wow, this is a complete deviation from Resident Evil, but is that really
they've talked about like what that demo is not the game, like you're not playing as that character you play as in the demo. And it looks like there will be some sort of combat, which there isn't in the demo. But if they're doing a whole VR thing with it, you have to imagine it's going to be something similar of that perspective. Like, they give you a glimpse of how your inventory works, and it's very kind of adventure game-esque. Like, in the demo, you get, like, lock cutters or some sort of cutter, and then you cut the chains off a locked cabinet and stuff, and you like you go into your menu and use it and stuff, so it's very adventure gamey. and it was pretty, I'll admit, it was pretty scary. I mean, like,
atmospheric.
Yeah, like, there's a point where you go upstairs, and it's kind of cheap scares. Like, it doesn't seem to have... It's kind of the differentiation that's always been between Resident Evil and Silent Hill, where it's like, Silent Hill, you like, if you play that PT thing, like, you have no idea what the fuck is going on. Resident Evil feels more like a haunted house. That's like, you know, it's all fun and games a little bit, because it, like, you go in and then you go up some stairs and then you turn around and there's a fucking store mannequin right behind you.
Right.
Like, where you were. And it's cheaper, scary, but it was still fun, scary. A lot of people were saying, like, well, just don't call it Resident Evil. And it's like, the Resident Evil name is so fucked.
Right.
That it's like, why do you care? Because at this point, it's like, you can't...
Well, you know that they were just like, they've been waiting for over a decade to be able to spell evil with the Roman numeral, yeah. 7.
Yeah, they have to. They have to at least get the 7th one.
And they have to be the first to do it, because now nobody else can do that. But
it's like, you can't remake, like, the first 3 or 4 games, like, that style. Like, people just will not respond to that.
The thing is, those games were great at the time. I never really liked Resident Evil, but I did play Code Veronica and even Silent Hills. You know, that era of gaming doesn't translate well now.
Well, I mean, I misspoke, because they have remade them, and they are remaking them. So, and there are people who like those remakes, but I just don't think you can make a new type of horror game with that style of gameplay. That wouldn't, like, it would just be the people who are playing, like, the Resident Evil remaster. And they've shown, for some reason, they can't get the magic back that happened with Resident Evil 4. For all the games they've made that have tried to reclaim that, haven't really been able to merge the two styles of game. So now it's this weird situation where Konami releases this PT thing and then they just pull out of fucking video games pretty much. And then the fan made thing is not really filling that void because it's canceled.
Yeah. We still haven't got the explanation behind it, have we? Like, they said that they would say more about it, but, like, the guy's like, the announcement itself was, we have to, you know, we're sad to announce where this game's been canceled. We'll have more to say in the future, but...
I think it's just I don't know. They haven't said more, but I think it's just a case of biting off more than you can chew when you're a small team like that. You know, like, think about who was originally on Silent Hills. Like, you had all, like, Kojima...
They did have a publisher behind it, though. I wonder if they got too eager to sign that publishing deal and didn't, you know, like, read the fine print or whatever and realize that they're screwed.
Yeah, but, that's awesome. But so you got this situation now where, like, people were so hyped for it. It doesn't surprise me at all that Capcom's like, well, let's just do that. Like, how about we try that with our horror game property, and, like, people might get what they want. And like I said, like, there's no, like, the Resident Evil title is in the shitter, so it's like there's nothing to lose by doing something really radical like that. And the demo seemed, you know, pretty good. It didn't seem great. Like I said, like, Resident Evil has always been a little sort of cheaper version of horror, and you can definitely tell that it still doesn't seem as smart as PT did, but it seemed fun.
Yeah.
Final Fantasy 15, we talked about that.
Yeah, like, sadly, it wasn't bad enough to make me not.
Well, I want it to be good.
Yeah.
Like, I want to like a Final Fantasy game, and it just, like, I really hope that dude just sucked. I really hope that fight isn't as bad as he made it look. And I definitely hope you don't have to do it multiple times in that game. But really, they didn't, like, nothing they showed. Like, they showed Final Fantasy 15 VR stuff, which I don't know if that's an actual game or just something they're doing at E3. Once again, more VR confusion. But that looked fucking terrible too. Yeah. Like that, it looked janky and weird and just unnecessary. So yeah, I don't understand what the hell happened there. Because this is like the last, well, I guess there's a PAX, but like this was really your time to like sell this game to people. And it's like beyond just being like, hey, this is the next one.
Here's some dudes riding around in a car.
Yeah. Sea of Thieves, we talked about that. Love pirates, hate people.
I brought it up. It's like, well, if, as long as we can two-man a crew, me and you could play. But I don't think that would make it any better for you. It'd probably make it worse. Because I'm so terrible at games, you'd just be getting pissed.
Get the cell out of my eyes. And then we just crash into a rock. No, that would probably be the only way to make that okay.
I did really like the mental image of me and you in like a rowboat in the middle of the sea, just like going in circles because we can't agree on like our rowing pattern or something. But just
keep
like
going northeast, Mr. Steve.
Still like happily at the top of our lungs, belting out Black Flag sea shanties.
Yeah, just fucking going until we run out of mead. So the Bethesda conference, they announced Quake. Didn't really. They just showed like that pre.
Yeah, and I put that on my list of, like, I didn't make, like, a specific, like, oh, my favorite games or the ones I'm most excited about. But anytime a game that I wasn't already aware of came along and caught my attention, I jotted it down. And that was when I jotted it down. Mostly, though, because it was just a trailer. I don't know that there was any gameplay or if there was. There might have been some actual gameplay. I don't remember if that was, like, simulated game per play or whatever, but it does look like they're capturing the feel of the original Quake, and that game was a very important game as far as my like early gaming. I mean, that's one of the games that got me into video games as much as I am today, so it's something I'm certainly going to pay attention to.
I think especially after Doom, like I you know, it'll be interesting to see what lessons they can take from Doom and apply it to a more multiplayer-driven game like Quake. But Doom was outstanding, and you know, Quake is definitely on my radar. Like it seems like they are finding some pretty cool ways to pull these old franchises back up. But then there wasn't really much. Like they showed a lot of stuff from like Fallout. The one thing that really stood out to me, funny enough, it was the Skyrim remaster and how fucking good that looked.
Yeah, the thing is, and it's they kind of have a point. I'm like, I'm watching that and I'm like, okay, is it coming to PC? And it's like, well, PC, we really already have the mods to make it look like that.
Yeah.
But I was the same way. I was excited to see it. I think we've talked about it before. For the last like year or so, I've had this itch to go back to Skyrim. But I don't. I have it on PlayStation 3, and it's one of those that it's if I see it on Steam for like $5, I'll buy it, and it goes on sale for that from time to time.
Yeah. Well, there was also a thing where like if you got the Legendary Edition of Skyrim, you could upgrade to the remaster for free, I think. So like where I work, we you know all of our Legendary Editions of Skyrim sold immediately. But like they were. What people were saying about it was, I guess they like to make it work on the consoles. Like it wasn't just a case of like, oh, we, you know, we added lighting and new textures and shit. Like they had to do a lot of overhaul to the base game to make it look that good. So, you know, that, you know what that means, right? Is a lot more fucking glitches. but yes. Yeah, I think I'm, you know, I'm ready to play that game again, and if it looks that good, then I'll be really, you know, like, I'll be stoked. Because that's how, like, it's that case where it's been so long since I've played that game that how they showed it at E3 is how I remember that game looking. But I know if I go back and play it, I'm like, oh, ugh, this is rough. But, yeah, that looked good. Kojima came out.
And it's a huge misstep to not just call that game Norman Reedus Presents His Naked Ass.
Norman Reedus's butt.
because that's what the internet seems to want. They all went crazy for it.
That, I went nuts for his butt.
It looked, I mean, we didn't get to see anything. Have they showed any more since the reveal, or is that really all? Because all I saw was the reveal trailer during Sony's.
No, it was classic Kojima, where it's just that, and you're left going, what the fuck?
Here's all these.
I know this is a Metal Gear Solid game, but how? You know, like,
here's all these dead fish on a beach. Oh, and here's naked Norman Reedus and a baby with the umbilical cord still attached.
But then no baby, then just oil, an invisible baby.
And then some dots in the sky that look like flying people, like watching. Yeah. And then you're like, huh?
Yeah, my first
not a
response.
Single damn thing makes sense here, but I want this.
Yeah, it was kind of that, like, well, and I think that's where Metal Gear Solid 5 did a lot to, like, raise Kojima's stake in my eyes, where it's just like, okay, he can make a game that's fun for me to play. So now it's like, all right, now I'm in for this weird shit. Whatever you're doing, I want to see. And it just goes to show that they really, like, Kojima really didn't need Silent Hill. Like, Silent Hill needed Kojima.
Well, yeah. But I'm loving all this because, you know, Konami was like, yeah, video games aren't profitable. This is stupid. We're cutting ties with that. We're making pachinko machines and mobile apps. And now all this stuff keeps happening, and you know they're sitting here like, son of a bitch.
Like,
son
this will
of
be
a
real,
bitch.
Well, they might be saying that. They might be thinking he'll fall flat on his face.
Well, yeah.
But this will be a really important game, I think, for Kojima, because like I said, like, I think MGS5 was a huge step in showing, like, not only can he make his weird shit, but he can make something that's fun. And I think if he can keep going down that path, Konami will have cut ties with him at the exact worst point. Like,
right.
Like, if they had just held on, like, you could see a guy entering his, like, prime years of game design.
See, and that's what we talked about. It's easy to side with Kojima and be like, Konami's all stupid and bad and evil. And it's like, more realistically, there was probably a lot of issues there. But sure. Yeah, like you said, where they severed their ties was probably the worst possible. Like, Konami took all the downfall, you know, basically budget. Yeah. And now everybody else, and now Kojima's reaping the, like, benefits of writing.
Yeah, everybody loves Kojima. Everybody's, like, laughing at Konami's empty, like, booth at E3. That, like, Dan Reichert took a picture, like, there's still a room for Konami there. Like, that's just been there for, I guess, years, and it's just nothing's there. So it's like people are using it to podcast out of and shit. This was, this is a weird one for me. Crash Bandicoot.
Like, that's not even a new game. That's just a remake.
Yeah, well, they're remastering them, and they're putting him in Skylanders. I don't know why you're remastering them. Like, those games are not going to fucking hold up. They don't. Like, I've gone back and played them. They are definitely a product of their time. Right. And I understand, like, the affection people have for Crash. But it's not going to work. Like, it's, those remasters are going to come out, and it's, you know, I don't think Naughty Dog would touch those games at this point.
Well, if you're going to do it, you got to do, we were just talking about it in chat, and me and you talked about it last week, the ukulele. Like, that's taking the spirit of, now I may be speaking too soon, the game's not out, it could come out and suck too, but mm-hmm. It looks like it's shaping up really well. It's like, yeah, you can take that spirit of game and use the modern sensibilities and the things that we've learned over the last 15 years of making video games, and you can make an awesome game. But instead, they want to just remaster.
Yeah, and I think the problem with Crash, though, even if you tried to, like, take, you know, the spirit of that, like, I don't know how you take the spirit of that game, because it was just breaking boxes.
Yeah, see, that's the other thing. I don't have a lot of experience with Crash, because it's one that came around just as I was going to, like, college, and I didn't really, I missed that whole series. Banjo I played, Banjo-Kazooie on the N64. It was probably the last of those type of games, unless you count Conker's Bad Fur Day, which was more of a, like, a parody of that genre.
Yeah.
But
like I played Crash all the time. I played Spyro. Spyro holds up a little better. But like Crash was such a straightforward thing, and since I played it at a friend's house, you know, a couple months ago, and I was just like, wow, this is really fucking rough. Like platformers, I'm curious how you remaster it, because so much of that game's challenge and pain in the ass was its fixed camera, so you have no perspective on your jumps. So I have no idea how people are going to respond to that. Like, what do you mean I can't like turn the fucking camera around? And if you can turn the camera around, will it still be Crash Bandicoot? Will it make everything way too easy?
Well, the other thing you could do is just release a VR remake of Psychonauts.
Yeah. And they'll do that. Yep. That'll be another Kickstarter.
No, they announced it.
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't pay any attention.
It wasn't in a big show. I just saw it somewhere yesterday or today.
Oh. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Now,
I don't know. My impression, I didn't read it. I didn't have time. But my impression is it's just like a VR edition of the original Psychonauts, not a new Psychonauts game. But it sounds like they're adding new mechanics and stuff to kind of compensate for.
Yeah. That. Whatever. If Tim Schafer wants to keep playing around with Psychonauts, that's really.
Well, they announced Psychonauts 2 finally, didn't they?
There was some weird shit to that. I don't even want to try remembering like all the weird shit that went into the funding of that. It was some crowdfunding thing, but it was like they called it like a crowd investment or something. There was a lot of weird shady shit to it. So yeah, Crash Bandicoot, like when the guy came out on stage and his shadow was Crash, and it was
so poorly matched up to him too. I loved it.
Yeah. I was just kind of like, you know, your big reveal there is that you're remastering him, but the only thing you have of substance is that he's going to be in Skylanders. Like, yes. Way to totally miss the boat on what people are excited for.
It certainly seemed like an announcement that would have been better anywhere except your main press conference.
Right. You know, and they made such a big fucking show of it with that display. Ghost Recon Wildlands kind of talked about it. Banner sucks. Like, there's aspects of it that kind of reminded me of MGS5. You know, like, the idea of, like, getting to a place and then, like, figuring out how you're going to infiltrate it and stuff. But there was no infiltration. Like, the guys just, like, they were making jokes about it, but they didn't do anything to infiltrate. Like, they just started shooting people. And it was kind of...
They were like, oh, let's go about this stealthily. And then immediately open fire. It's like,
Yeah. And like, I know they were trying to do, like, a comedic effect thing, but it's, like, I want to actually see you infiltrate there. Like, that's what I liked about MGS5 was, like, trying to not get into a giant gunfight unless it was, like, a last resort thing. That game looks like it has some potential, but it was another case of, like, what they actually showed left me kind of down on it.
Down in the dumps bin.
Dishonored 2. I didn't. People seemed really high on what they showed, and really? Like I loved Dishonored, but I was kind of just like numb to it. Like I was just like, okay.
Yeah. See, that's the thing. My impression of it, and I didn't love Dishonored. I never finished it, but I didn't hate it. It was a good game, but I sucked at it. You know that well. It's like one of the first games I streamed. But Dishonored 2, what they showed, I bored the crap out of me. But at the same time, it didn't, like, lower my expectations for the game. It's like, Yeah, I basically know what we're going to get. And it's like, and they really didn't show any new. It's like, oh, you have a new character with new powers. It's like, I fucking hope so, because if not, then you're just giving me expansion to the first game.
I'm just saying, if she's entirely trained by Corvo, the bumbling assassin, we're all fucked.
Now, what they need to announce is a co-op mode for that, where you can each play as one of the characters. Yeah. Because then me and you would have a damn, like, hell of a time being the world's worst assassin duo. Yeah.
There were points in that demo where it's like, okay, we're going to we're going to kill those two guys and then throw an explosive barrel and it's going to look sick. And it looked just fucking messy.
Awkward, yeah.
Yeah, like none of it looked as slick as I remember the first game feeling. But at the same time, I love Dishonored so much that it's like, it's kind of like I didn't really need them to show me anything to be like, yeah, I'll play a Dishonored 2. I mean, unless it's completely fucking busted. So, yeah, I was kind of surprised how well received that was, but I thought it looked kind of messy, but, you know, still interested. South Park guys revealed they're making another one with a different team.
Yeah, and I can't remember if I said something or just thought it, because I have conversations with myself, and they kind of blur in with real life.
Yeah. Tyler Durden.
Right. It's like I'm happy that they announced it. I have zero interest in it. The Stick of Truth was good. I enjoyed it, but it's all the South Park I really needed, but I'm not a big South Park fan anymore. I haven't really watched the show since the 90s, so...
What kind of turns me off to it is, like, I still watch the show occasionally, but I'm kind of... exhausted by like these last few seasons. I've had so much of like the Coon and like all these superhero episodes that I'm just sort of like, do I want to play a game that's all about the superhero stuff?
Right.
I do have the Stick of Truth. I haven't played it yet, and that's probably why. Like, what they showed looked interesting. Like, they're changing the combat a little bit. Like, there's like placements, like positions matter and stuff for like attacks. And, like, that seems interesting to me, but at the same time, yeah, it's South Park. If you get too much of it at once, then it's like dessert. You can't overdo it.
Well, you can overdo it, but it's bad.
It's bad. It'll end poorly. Prey.
I missed Prey. And
yeah, well, I think everybody did, based off what they showed off. There's none... I didn't even... It was the weirdest goddamn thing they could have shown to be a Prey game.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, I saw... Because that was Bethesda as well, right?
Yes.
That's what we're still on. So, of course, I saw it because I watched Bethesda's thing, but it didn't leave enough of an impression that I completely forgot about it. And then every time somebody mentions, oh, yeah, and Prey, I'm like, oh, yeah. Was that good? I can't remember what I saw.
Yeah, there wasn't much to it. Like, a guy had a bloodshot eye and then was being attacked by a fucking black thing, like a black beast alien thing. And it was the most, like, I was, like, watching it, and then when it said Prey, I, like, what I saw and the name Prey did not click together at all, so now I'm just, like, my mind's a mess when I try to think of it. Like, I, no opinion, they didn't really show much. I just... It didn't. I don't know what the hell it is.
Oh yeah, I just had to look it up, and as soon as I saw the thumbnail, I remember the trailer. It's that was weird. Dead Space is what I got the most like impression of.
I got a Dead Space kind of like meets Portal vibe.
Yeah,
but that might just be set up.
The thing that's going to be disappointing to me is when they showed Prey at E3 like 2010. And it was going to be this, like, you're this space alien bounty hunter. And they had, like, that whole, like, walkthrough mission that was all pre-recorded or whatever. It turned out to not be gameplay. And that was right before that whole shit hit the fan. And the whole project's just like, whoops.
Yeah. Whoops.
But that whole concept of being an, like, space cowboy bounty hunter was like, that sounds fucking awesome.
Yeah.
And now we're not getting that. It's like, well, but... this might be cool, but give me my bounty hunter. Like,
yeah, let me make my Cowboy Bebop game.
Right.
Just give me all your money, and I'll make that game, and everybody will get what they want.
So, yeah.
We talked about Quake. Sony ended theirs with Days Gone.
I have no idea why. No. It looked like a poor man's Dead Rising, which I'm not a fan of that either, but...
Well, yeah, it looked like Dead Rising meets Last of Us, and it's like, if you're going to do a zombie game, one, don't, because there's a lot of them.
I like that.
Two, do one or the other, really well. Don't try to do this like mishmash.
I like that the gameplay that they gave us, it was like, it wasn't a live on stage crappy player like you've been complaining about, but it was like a pre-recorded gameplay. But the stupid guy playing it kept stopping every like 10 feet to turn around and shoot at, like, there's a horde of like 5,000 zombies, and he'd turn around to shoot like five of them. I'm like, what the fuck was the point of that?
Yeah, Jeff Gerstmann was talking about that during it. It's like, quit fucking turning around, dude.
Right.
They're still there. And just, yeah, you can tell, like, they're going for, like, that emotional kind of, like, serious sort of infected story. But it's like, what is your selling point on the gameplay? Is that there's a lot of them?
Yeah, that's what it seemed
Dead
to be.
Because, like you said, Dead Rising did all that.
Well, and there's a new Dead Rising coming out that's... Because that's what it's like, yeah, but look how many we have. We have hundreds. And it's like, yeah, so does this new Dead Rising game. Like, yeah. I saw somebody tweet, they got hands-on in the new Dead Rising game. They're like, I can't even see the floor. There's that many zombies. It's like, yeah, great. Like,
yeah, and I'm not a huge Dead Rising fan.
No, I...
But they have their niche.
Like, the thing is, the Dead Rising that I played two. And I think I would have absolutely loved it, but they introduced that retarded mechanic where you only... you only have so much time, like, or else you lose. Like, it doesn't let you just play around with the crafting mechanic and the being stupid and like just killing zombies. If you, it limited you. You had to like complete the next step within like 20 minutes in game time or whatever, or you lost. And I'm like, no, give me the endless. It just let me play in the sandbox zombie world.
Yeah. Like, yeah, don't put, like, time limits on stuff. Like, don't make me feel like a failure for wanting to have fun.
Right, especially in a game that's about finding, like, you could strap a machete to a remote control helicopter and just fly it over the crowd cutting zombie heads off.
Dressed up like fucking Mega Man with, like, a beer gut.
Exactly. You know? Like, in a game that's its core, let me play with the toys that you're giving me. Don't, like, be like, oh, you could do all this stuff, but for 2 minutes and now...
Yeah. Yeah, I think the design of that game was like, yeah, they were trying something unique, but I don't think they really understood like what people would like about that game. It had nothing to do with like restrictions and time constraints.
Well, to me it was a conflict between having this like stupid bonkers action-y, like, just dumb, guilty pleasure, kill zombie game, and then also wanting to make it an honest-to-goodness, like, video game. It's like, no, it just embrace what you are, and that'll be great. So I didn't like 2 at all, and that's about the only one. I think I played a little bit of some of the demos to either the... That's one of those games that or series that has the confusing, like, there's 1, and then there's 2, and then there's, like, a subtitled one that's kind of a... like a standalone DLC. I'm like, well, if it's standalone and DLC, it's a new, it's another game.
Yeah. After I played the first one, I had kind of that same problem. And then I was just like, okay, well, don't need to play these anymore. And now I'm so fucking done with zombies. It's ridiculous.
That's the thing.
I'm so exhausted with it. But you know what doesn't seem to have zombies? Or at least zombies of a more metaphorical level? Is We Happy Few.
Yes, that's a game. I wrote a it might have just been like a preview or like a news piece, something about it when it first got announced. Because
God, it looks good.
I know, that immediately caught my eye because it takes that almost the zombie premise, but they're not. It looks like something that could be directed by like Stanley Kubrick. It's that weird... If you haven't seen, look it up because I'm not going to do it justice explaining it. But it's like you're in this weird dystopian future where everybody has like these mime face painted faces, and you require, or I guess they're masks. I think.
Something.
Or I don't know. Maybe I guess I don't. They're weird. Well, they just look like these like demented happy clowns.
Yeah, it's this really weird kind of Orwellian nightmare verse where like everybody's. Like artificially happy.
Yeah, you can tell delusional. Like things are actually shit, but the government makes you, or just society makes you take these pills where you makes you happy, but you literally hallucinate that things are great. Like when they're eating
pinata
and you find out it's a rat. Like they're just eating its guts and gross, but
Yeah, it looks like scary in a way that's like it's not.
It's disturbing. Yeah.
Yeah, like it's a genuinely scary idea to me.
And that's what,
because you're just being hunted by these like fucking people who think they're just happy and like you're not taking your medicine.
And would they call you a downer or something? We got a downer or whatever.
Yeah. and it looks. I think it's going to have its early access release July.
Yeah, it should be fairly soon. And I like I said, I've had my eye on that for a long time. And what they showed, like, just completely, like, the interest I already had, it just, like, amped it up to a million because it looked off. I also liked that your protagonist is just this regular guy. When the person that you're with figures out that you're not on your meds and then, like, calls the alarm, and there's like these old like English Bobby looking police guys come chasing after you. I love that you get cornered and you see them break off a pipe like, okay, I'll fight. But you're not some all of a sudden super like martial artist. Like,
no. And like everything they've showed in that game, that's the one thing I'm worried about is like it just looks like you just get your ass kicked the entire fucking game.
Yeah, I love that because you grabbed it and you're like, okay, now he's going to take these guys out. And he got like one half swing on and it got like blocked and he just got beat to a pulp. And you're like, oh.
Yeah, you're definitely not a fighter in that one. But it was reminding me of like all this stuff they really released for Bioshock before that game came out, where it's like your guy getting fucking drilled in the stomach. And it's just like, man, I'm not going to win, am I?
So that looks really cool. And like you said, it should be available to play at least in early access form relatively soon.
Yeah, the early access, what I was reading last night was like it won't have any of the story stuff in there and it won't be like the full game, but they want to put stuff out there, I think, one, for funding, but also just to, you know, give feedback what needs to be fixed or whatever. I have no idea, like, where the, like, who's working on this game, like, what their history is. But everything I've seen of it looks frightening and just awesome. So that was probably one of the highlights of E3 for me.
I agree. That's one of the ones that I've had at the top of my... Like I said, I didn't, like, do a full out because I haven't seen everything yet. But, that's one of the games that I was most interested in after seeing.
Like, for me, it was probably the games that looked the best to me that, like, I thought had the best showing were, like, We Happy Few. I thought Horizon looked pretty good. And then Zelda. I think everybody's kind of talking about Zelda.
Zelda, I to give more detail than I need to, I had to race home after work and mow my lawn before we started the show because it's supposed to storm here for like the next 3 days. And while I was mowing, I was kind of thinking about it because at first I was kind of thinking, I'm like, you know, it's cool that they're adding this stuff to Zelda, but is it to the point where it doesn't even like make it a Zelda game anymore? And then I thought, you know what? What it really is coming across as to me is them finally understanding that the main Zelda fan base, the people that grew up playing Zelda, are older now. And
well, it's like, and the older fans want something a little different, and new Zelda fans can like something different, you know. And it's like there's nothing to lose by trying something radical like that, you know. And from what I've heard from a lot of people who've been playing it at E3 is that it's definitely taking a lot, like what they were originally saying when they first revealed the game is they wanted to capture that spirit of the first Zelda where you just sort of come out into the world and you have to find your own way around. And it seems like they're really going that route, which is still Zelda. I mean, you know, we like the framework that started with A Link to the Past, but I am kind of happy that they are trying something new with it. But really a lot of my optimism for the game is just that art style.
Yeah.
It looks so fucking beautiful.
Well, were they automatically, I'm going to have to buy it and apparently a Wii U cause I still don't have one in
or an NX.
Yeah, it's true. I was watching the IGN people play or do their demo and it's like, oh, he killed the goblin or the Gopkin or whatever. or Bob-oblin or whatever. I think that's what they're called.
Bob-oblin.
Anyway, they killed one, and then it's like, oh, he dropped the traveler sword. And it's like, what? There's, like, actual, like, loot? It's like, well, fuck, because I'm addicted to that to begin with. Like,
and it's not, and, like, the one thing they showed off a lot is how you're going, like, a big part of the combat is picking up the enemy's weapons, which they did a little bit in Wind Waker. But you pick up their weapons, and, like, that will primarily be your offense, is switching through those weapons on the fly of, like, all right, disarm this guy, take his spear, and then use the spear here. And, like, it seems interesting.
And they have a full-fledged block and, like, dodge and counter system. That's not been, and it's not motion-based.
There you go. So, 10 out of 10.
That's what a lot of the people that have played it say, like, man, this almost feels Dark Souls-like, the combat. It's like, huh. Now, I wonder how much of that's because Dark Souls is so fresh in all of our memories. But
or Dark Souls infects everything around it and makes it better. That's where I stand on that. But yeah, like I to me, it's really the art style. Like, just it looks very like I get real like Studio Ghibli vibes. Yeah.
I mean, they flat out said that they're like, we want the visuals to look like Japanese animation.
And like, now they have like they kind of did like they mixed animation with like sort of painting color tones, and it looks really good. And the fact that it's going to be in HD, like, you know, I have my problems with Skyward Sword, but I think that game would have looked really good if like you got the HD treatment. I thought it looked good anyway, but I thought it really would have, like, maybe I could have forgiven some of its shit if it was
probably not.
But yeah, like, knowing how Wind Waker looks on the Wii U and stuff, and like, I'm pretty excited about that. And everything they're changing with the gameplay, it's like, you know, at least they're taking a shot. I know a lot of people were kind of fixated on the gender swap thing.
That one, I thought everybody was reaching, and I don't.
Like I think, you know, in a situation where Link is just kind of this blank avatar, I think you should have that option now. I didn't always feel that way, but I've kind of changed my mind on it. But at the same time, like I, it's hard for me to like really care. Like I think the game looks gorgeous. If Link doesn't say anything anymore, I don't think it makes that big of a difference.
He's so androgynous looking anyway, just pretending he's a girl. I mean,
yeah, nobody fucking knew.
Right.
Like, the only reason we know now is because his shirt was off at the beginning.
Kind of what I had to laugh so much, because leading up to right before they showed it off, Nintendo gave out the lanyards for a lot of companies. That's like their thing at conferences, is here's a lanyard for your pass. And there was Link on one side, and then Link with his hood and a bow on the other, and everybody was like breaking that down, like, oh, the chin's more rounded on the bowed one, it's obviously female, oh, they leaked it. It's like, no,
I don't think they look that different, but they did look different. Sure. So I thought there was more to it, but, you know, like I said, I'm not too worried about it. I'm kind of wondering if, like, in Nintendo's mind, Link is more of a character to them than it is to a lot of people who play Zelda, where he's not just this blank template. Because they were trying to explain why they didn't give that choice, and they were saying, well, we didn't want to just do a male-female Link. If we were going to do a female character, it would be Zelda. But then if Zelda's doing the game, like, then what does Link do?
Right.
And it's like, no, you could have made a female Link. Like, it would have...
Well, the way that they have all these, like, multiverses anyway, they're like the Final Fantasy of, well, I said of Nintendo, I guess. There had been some Final Fantasies on Nintendo. But anyway, yeah, like, they have this, like, the whole story is like this reoccurring alternate reality, like, between installments. It'd be very easy to interject a female Link, or just a new character, come up with a new character altogether.
Yeah.
Like, But yeah, like I said, it's not. I'm not any more or less disappointed. And of course, we're we're male, so kinda, I think that's part of that. It's like
it's part of that. That's definitely a part of it. Like maybe your fucking heart is broken for this, but to me, it's also I don't like setting up like ill will because game creators are making a game that's not the game I want to to make. Like I feel like you should be more reacting to what they made rather than like what they could have made. In a situation of like who do you play as and stuff, it's like, well, it's their game, you know, let's see what they do with it. Like, cuz you know, I think the choice should be there, but because it doesn't mean like they're wrong for not doing it. It's just it's their creative right.
Nope, burn them down to the ground.
Yeah, burn them down. Fuck them. Well, fuck Nintendo for fucking Paper Mario, man.
I hadn't seen that because, like I said, I missed Nintendo's altogether. I see like a shy guy like sucking off Toadstool until he lost all of his color. That's probably been too long ago. It was right when we started the show on Twitter. I think that's like a mechanic. It looks like he had a straw, like you could just like suck the ink off the page, but it was a very unfortunate like positioning of everything.
Yeah. Sucks what the fuck happened to Paper Mario, and I didn't know this. I just read about this today. It was, I guess, Miyamoto like decreed after Super Paper Mario that he didn't want that team to make new characters in Paper Mario anymore. So like somebody posted a really funny comparison thing of like, here's all the different Toads you meet in Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door, and it's like Ghost Toad, and like there's like this Rockstar Toad, and like all sorts of different Toads, like all these crazy character designs, and then like here's Sticker Star and all this other shit, and it's just the same basic Toad, just like compared like just a million of them, and like that sucks, like because like the Paper Mario series made some of the best like settings for any Mario game. And part of that was because it had such funny characters. I was, when they were rumoring a new Paper Mario game for the Wii U, I was really excited. Maybe this one will be good, but I fucking doubt it, because like they just sucked all the personality of what like made Paper Mario cool.
You're just making me laugh with your phrasing, considering what I just retweeted one picture. It's not the one I'm looking for, but if you check out my Twitter feed, it goes, not just you specifically, Ben, anybody, it's one example of what I was talking about. There was an animated GIF that it looked even better.
He's full-blown sucking his dick, isn't he?
Yeah.
Wow, look at him go.
That's what the poster said there. Oh, that's right from the press kit. I mean, it's not like, oh, that's been altered for hilarity or something. Yeah. But,
not thrilled with how that looks. Kind of the surprise for me is how interesting Mafia 3 looks to me.
I hadn't seen it from E3, but I've seen some stuff prior, because that's not one that they just announced or anything.
Yeah, no. And I saw a little bit about that, but I watched like their gameplay demo today, and the gameplay, like, it's kind of that thing of like, well, is this going to just be another open world game? Like, and oh, hey, here's your mission. Go over here, drive over here and shoot that guy. But I really like the setting, and I like sort of the characterization they're giving everything. Like, it really like hits that sort of like gangster movie appeal with me. And like, they're doing a really sort of gritty take on like a New Orleans type city. I forgot what they actually like what they called it, but they said it was obviously inspired by New Orleans. So I thought that looked pretty good overall. But just a lot of questions about open world games right now where it's like, do I really, does every game need to do this?
Yes, is, every single game needs to do
this. Is this going to be exhausting going to the goddamn point on my map all the time? Like, can I just ever, like, know which way to go? But that's all I have on my list.
Oh, you missed a couple. And I wanted to mention, because you had talked about We Happy Few, and you said you don't know what games they made. The only other game that they've put out was interesting. It didn't do so well sales-wise, but it was Contrast, that game with the female protagonist, and it was, like, about using the shadows as a mechanic. Mm-hmm. And you can tell from the aesthetic, they're very similar visually. Man, I said that weird because I could barely get those words
visually
out. Similar visually. Anyway, the only two games that I have in mind that you didn't really mention, For Honor, I thought looked pretty cool. That's a Ubisoft game.
There might have been more to it. The reason I didn't put that one on there was, like, I tried to watch their thing and it just kind of looked like Dynasty Warriors, like more historically truthful Dynasty Warriors.
I don't know about historically truthful, but
in terms of, like, you weren't wearing like a fucking, like, you were dressed like a Viking.
Yeah, that's true. I think I liked it because it was that. I mean, it looks like that guilty pleasure, like, melee combat action game.
It didn't look bad. I never really got into that sort of Dynasty Warriors brawler thing.
But it's got the really cool blocking and counter mechanic, and I love melee games with a good blocking and counter mechanic. So I put that one on. It could be really repetitive and bad, but it's got my attention. It's had my attention anyway. The other one, and you've had to see me tweet on this because it blew my mind. Like, I didn't pay attention to who was making it, and they showed the trailer. I'm like, that could be really cool. But Detroit Become Human, where it's like they showed off. It seems like the protagonist isn't the one from the trailer, or that you'll play multiple. It's about androids. And what they showed off was a demo of an android going rogue and taking a little girl hostage. And you go through the level, and you can find different clues, and you talk to the guy ultimately. And there's, depending on how you, what you found, what information you have, and what your responses are, you know, there's different outcomes. And I'm like, but it's a whole, like, kind of cool cyber futuristic aesthetic. And I'm like, that could be really cool, could be really bad, but I thought it looked really cool, and I had my interest. And it's like, oh yeah, Quantic Dreams or whatever. I'm like, yeah, wait a minute.
Fuck.
And somebody said something like, oh yeah, David Cage. And I'm like, son of a bitch.
And that was the thing. Like, I was impressed by that trailer too, but I know who made it.
Right.
So I'll happily be proven wrong, but I know that game won't be
because
what I want.
Because he'll
to be.
Do what he does, where his ideas on paper seem really cool, and they show that, and it seems really cool, and then his execution sucks.
Right. And that's where I'm at with it, is like, I maybe this will be the one, but I fucking doubt it. I think that was a good showing.
It really sucked because they showed it and I was really excited for it. Then I realized who was making it. It's like, ah, damn.
That's when it goes the other way. Like, if Kojima puts his name on something, right now he has such goodwill with everybody. Everybody's interested. David Cage is like the other version of that, where it's like, ah, shit, he's a part of it. God damn it.
It was basically like when our local dog kennel, or dog, you know, the pound, posts a picture and it's like, oh, here's this really cute puppy that came into the pound. You're like, sweet. And they're like, we just put it down. You're like, oh,
thank you for showing me that and making my fucking day great.
Now I'm lying. Our kennel is a no-kill kennel, but
that's pretty cool.
It's a good analogy though, where it gets your hopes up and then instantly you're like, oh wait.
Yeah. Washington's a state that just seems to look for reasons to put fucking animals down.
We have kill kennels around, and I think they have in the past. I think it was within the last few years that they've changed to no kill. But and what a lot of these kennels do is, like, we're a no kill kennel, but then if they have a dog that's been there and they can't get rid of it, then they just ship it to a kill kennel. It's like, see, we didn't get it, put it down.
You did fucking kill it, you liar.
But
anyway. So yeah.
So those were the games of E3.
Yeah, there's plenty more. Everything they showed about Cuphead still looks fucking incredible.
Yeah, I was talking to somebody and they're like, oh, I worry it'll be too hard. I'm like, I hope it's hard, because then it's
no.
Both
Mike, I think that's his name. He was on the show once before. but you were talking to him about it, and he said, I forgot what how he put it. He said it looked too much like old Disney cartoons mixed with Mega Man.
Oh,
and I was like,
no, it wasn't him. I had that conversation too, and it's like you can't possibly look too much like an old Disney cartoon. Like that should be like, the bar that you're going for. But
well, yeah, and Mega Man. You can't say that and not be sarcastic.
Right.
Like there's
a really weird taste in video games. He's a cool guy, but his gaming tastes are not in line with mine at all.
I felt like I needed to take a shot after reading that.
Well, and to be honest, the Mega Man similarities were kind of interesting. I could see it a little bit, but to me it looked way more like Contra.
Yeah, but, I agree with you. I definitely got more vibes from that, especially when it's co-op.
Yeah.
Like that.
I mean, they even did the going prone to duck under shots and then shoot thing. Like, I was like, hey, this is...
Yeah, but
Steamboat really
plays
Contra, anyway.
My phone wallpaper for, years was Mega Man drawn in the style of an old Disney cartoon.
I didn't know that.
So, yeah.
Yeah, you have to change your pants after hearing that phrase, but...
Yeah, and so, seeing somebody be like, oh, wait, that seems stupid. Like, are you out of your mind?
Yeah, but I had a separate conversation with somebody else that they said they were to look like it could be too hard. And I brought up Ori, and it's like, yeah, Ori would have been a lot better if it wasn't so hard. I'm like, I don't think so. I think if you took the challenge away from Ori, I know you didn't love that game like I did anyway, but if you made it like just this easy, breezy, like childish platformer, then there would have been really not anything to offer other than, hey, look, it looks pretty.
Right.
To me, having it look like that, look as gorgeous and cool and unique as it does, and then the thought that it might be a deep, difficult, engaging game, that sounds awesome.
Yeah. I didn't like Ori that much, but the difficulty wasn't the thing that hindered that game.
No, it wasn't the type of, you like to be able to collect all
in a game about fucking exploration,
basically,
I'd like to be able to explore.
It broke the cardinal sin of those kind of games by locking you out of areas at certain points without warning.
Yeah.
As the kind of person that if I see the credits, I'm done with the game, even if I've technically, if the progress bar says I'm 10%, I'm like, nope, saw the credits, I'm done. So it didn't, that didn't bother me as much as it did you, but yeah. I get why it did.
But yeah, and I'm just like, I think people, I mean, it's their own taste, so play games how you want to, but I think a lot of people have gotten away from the, a game can be hard and challenging, and it's still fun and rewarding to put your time into. What's that?
Dark Souls.
Yes. Yeah, but just in general, it's well, I don't want to play something that's too hard.
No. And I totally get, sometimes you're not in the mood for that. That's fine.
Right.
I mean, I get that a lot.
Yeah, and I understand it, but I also, don't dismiss something just because it's going to, beat you a couple of times. See what Cuphead's about, huh?
And maybe that just shows that how used to most of us are to, hard meaning just unfair. Because a lot of designers, that's what they think hard is.
Well, also think about what you grew up with. For every game that had a reasonable difficulty curve, there was 20 in your library that were fucked.
Yeah.
And
ones that you wouldn't even expect, Bart versus the World. It's I don't know anybody that got past level one.
Yeah, because that game was shit.
Well, yeah, it wasn't a good game, but I mean, it was just...
It was also hard.
Right. It's a Simpsons game. Who the hell would have expected that? But
that game was fucked up, man. I can't believe you brought that up. Bring that up here.
There was two Simpsons games. That was that's the poster child for bad and difficult games. There was another Simpsons one that bad. And then there was Simpsons Arcade that at the time was great, but it...
My grandpa, he ran his own arcade, and one of the cabinets he kept was that Simpsons Arcade game. So every time I went to visit him, I would just go into his garage and fucking play...
Yeah.
Simpsons and think about the Black Widows that were in his garage.
If you go back and play it critically, which I did relatively recently, Xbox Live re-released it a couple years ago. And it's for this day and age, it's not a very good game. But at the time, it was what an arcade brawler it was good for that. But no, the NES offerings, Bart versus the World, and they were all Bart titled. I forget what the other one was. Not good. Not good.
Bart's Big Adventure. I don't know.
Somebody stole my bicycle.
Don't have a cow, man, yeah. And then you die. That's how all those games went. That's our E3.
Yeah, we're at two hours, and then we're starting to talk about old games instead of new stuff, so I think we're done.
Yeah, we'll call that a show. Thanks for tuning in. Anyone who tuned in, bye.
That was such a great sign-off. I'm going to leave it at that.